Thank you. Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
No, that was not good. Good morning and happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Much better. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Yes, I am.
Praise the Lord. May the worship experience bring a lasting expression to your hearts today. Let us hope in our hearts to receive the grace and wisdom that await us. For those that are watching online, please put in your prayer request and know that heaven sees your request and we are praying. Our praying answering God is on the job. Be encouraged. Whether you are joining us in person or virtually. Sorry about that. Whether you are joining us in person and virtually, know that you are a valued and cherished member of our church family. May God bless you as we worship together. May we stand as we pray. Father in heaven, we truly want to say thank you so much for your love and for your goodness for bringing here this morning. It is a privilege to be in your house one more time. As we go through our service, we pray that you will bless us, that you will continue to keep us. Be with those that are on their way. And I pray that when we leave here this morning, Lord, we will gain a blessing. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church family. Look, the Lord has done it again. The Lord has brought us into his presence this morning so we can magnify his holy name. And we say, thank you, Lord. And so let us enter his gates with thanksgiving and let's enter his courts with praise because our God is faithful. He is indeed a good God. And with these words, I want to welcome each and every single one of you, those that are in-house and those that are watching online, and also those that are visiting us for the first time. I want to welcome you all to our communion Sabbath. It's our precious time when we reflect on what the Lord has done for us, and it's a time that reminds us that we are not just any kind of people. We are a precious people bought with a precious price. We are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And so we come as a church to express our thanks to God. And church family, let's continue to pray for those among us who are going through so many challenges, financial challenges, health challenges, and so those that are currently sick in our congregation. As a church family, we pray for them, so we encourage you to continue to pray for someone you know who is sick. Let's also pray for Sister Rochelle Williams, who is currently in the hospital. And let's also pray for those who are currently mourning the loss of a loved one. Just recently, Brother Johnson tragically lost a cousin. And so please pray for comfort, pray for the family, asking the Holy Spirit to comfort them during this difficult time. To stay connected and to know what's happening at Central in the next few weeks and months, we invite you to continue to scan the QR code. It is updated so that you can see all the announcements in details. I'll not be going through everything for the sake of time today. And I'll just want to mention a few announcements. Next week, Master Guides are having their induction at 4 p.m. So I want to invite you to attend, to support them. Remember, next week, April 20th, 4 p.m. sharp, Master Guide induction. Next announcement, our revival series, as you know, is starting on April 21st to April 27th. The theme is Rebuild, Reborn, and Refocus. Rebuild, Reborn, and Refocus. Also, next week there is an officers' church officers' meeting in person here at Central at 6:30 p.m. So all the officers and the assistants, all those that are in positions of leadership, we invite you to attend. That's next week, April 20 at 6:30 p.m. Save the date for April 27. So that's 2 weeks from now. 2 weeks from now, April 27, we're going to have a church family meeting. And so if you want to know what's happening with where we were, well, if you come, you're going to hear updates on what's happening with our possibility project. So we want you to come. All the members are invited to attend 2 weeks from now, April 27th. That's going to be here at Central after sunset. Okay, so save the date for April 27. Education Day is on May 11, and the choir, the Crawford people, the Crawford Choir and Band will be joining us. And so save the date for May 11th, Education Day. And then the following day will be Mother's Day. So that's on May 12th. So just to have more details, to buy the tickets, please see Sister Blackwood. Last thing, our church family is having a retreat. Sorry? Yes, that's right. Our church family is having a retreat at Camp Fenda. And the retreat is happening in May, from May 17 to May 20. So please see the poster for more information, or you can reach out to Sister Cooper if you want more information. Last announcement, I'm going to pass it on to Brother Elder Renroy to talk about a special thing happening today.
My friends, if you could just put the Revelation seminar. Happy Sabbath, everyone. How is everyone doing? Amen. You're above ground.
Yes.
All right. So what we know what's happening this afternoon, right? At 5 o'clock. Let me see a show of hands of all those who are inviting someone to come out to our Revelation seminar. Oh, boy. Okay. I see one hand. I see one. Okay. Let me see a show of hands of all those who are going to be here. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So at we're starting at 5 o'clock sharp. You need to come early. Come maybe for the registration desk is going to be open at 4:15. We want everyone to register. When you register, you're going to get your questionnaire. Okay, those who are watching online, we hope you could come live. But if you can't make it on live, you could come on Zoom. I'm hearing stories that there are people as far as Brazil who are going to be coming on. So you know what? We just want the Holy Spirit to lead. I'm so excited about this. The whole concept about this is that we have a better understanding of Revelation. So we want you to come out, bring somebody out, so we know what is going on for us. Okay, so you know me, I'm the quiz master. Remember I asked you a question?
Yes.
Remember the question I asked? Who remember? What day was the revelation revealed? Does anyone know the answer?
Today.
Today? All right. Come today, come this evening, and you'll get the answer. God bless you. Enjoy our communion service today.
Amen.
All right. Thank you, Elder Renroy. There is a promotional video that we made for the revival. And so, Glenn, can you play it now? Please.
What shall we say to these things? They're still cancer and so much disease. What shall we say to these things? So much hurting and broken esteem.
So many questions, but still one answer.
Amen, amen. So we invite you to invite a friend to be there for our revival week. I want to leave you with this thought here, a song that I was listening to this morning, and the song says, there's no problem too big God cannot solve. There's no mountain too tall God cannot move it. He says, if he carried the weight of the world upon his shoulders, I know my brother, I know my sister, that he will carry you. May God bless you.
Good morning, pleasant Sabbath. And this is our call to worship. Please stand. Psalms 122, verse 1. Psalms 118, verse 1. I was glad when they said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Church, this is our call to worship.
Amen.
Enter into his courts with Heavenly Father, you are worthy of all praise. And for this, Lord, we have come into your house to worship you in spirit and in truth. We invite your holy Shekinah glory to grace this place. And as we worship you today, may we see your Son high and lifted up. And may we be closer drawn to you today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our hymn of continuation is number 163, At the Cross Where I First Saw the Light. 163. And did my Savior bleed?
Alas, and did my Savior bleed? And did my suffering die? Would he leave for that sacred hand for sinners such as I?
Someone get those two prayer box and place them right here for us, please. Thank you. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
And for those who are online, we want to welcome you in our service today. I hope that you'll be joining us in prayer wherever you are, in your living room, on your bed, wherever you are. Just come. and pray with us. And for those in the congregation, this morning is a special morning, because all week I've been talking to the Lord about this prayer box. There are some names in this box that the devil have done something to us. He's steal away so many of our young people. They are out there somewhere. Some of them got married in the process, and they have children in the process. And we want to claim what the devil stole from us. And so, while you're coming to the altar, I want you to keep in mind, we want you to pray for these individuals who have left our church. We have started the drive already. It's going to go through Sabbath school. Every one of us, if we really love the Lord, if we're really looking forward for the second coming of Jesus, you will be a part of this program, because these people need to come back to the Lord, and they're going to come back to the Lord through us. The Lord will work through us to bring them back. So while you're coming, keep in mind that you'll be praying for these individuals in the box, names that are in the box. Prayer song. Eternal Holy Father, we want to thank you for this another moment that you have granted unto us. Lord, as I contemplate throughout this week, and as I talked with you throughout this week, and the Spirit has revealed to me that the days are getting short. In Matthew chapter 24, you say, just for the elect's sake, the days will be shortened. I don't know, many of us know what is happening. But it was just last week, we were in church, and we're back again so fast. When I listened to the testimony of Sister Petula last week, I started to search myself and to see if I'm really in the faith or not. The doctor gave up. The doctor said to Brother Walron, go home and prepare for funeral. But Dr. Jesus said, no, not yet. Not yet. There are some people praying at Toronto Central on our behalf. And I am going to save her for a purpose. So Petula, wherever you are and you hear my voice, the Lord hasn't finished with you yet, my sister. There's work for you to do in your family. There's work for you to do in the church. Lord, as we come today, I pray that you will search us. And if there's any wicked ways in us, I pray that you will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, I see myself as Isaiah this morning. Dear Lord, I pray that you will take that live coal from off the altar and place it on my tongue, that it will burn out every dross of sin. Brethren, this is not the time to play church. This is the time to get serious with God. I have the time to search my life throughout this week and have a wonderful time with the Lord. My determination by thy grace, dear Lord, is to make heaven my home. Lord, in these boxes that I kneel before, there's some wonderful children who were once worshiping us, and they are in the world, including my son. I talk to that young man every day. My heart goes out for him. Dear Lord, I pray that we'll be serious in whatever we are doing, because the Lord is waiting on us. The Holy Spirit is waiting on us. The whole of heaven is waiting on us to do something about our walk with you. As the Apostle Paul said, it's not by might, not by power, but by thy Spirit, said the Lord. I lift up before you those online. I pray, dear God, that your Spirit will be with them in a very special way. If they don't know you, dear Lord, I pray that today they will come to know you. For whom to know is life eternal. Last week we have a wonderful service in this church, and today is another high day in Zion, because Lord, you promised that as often as we eat and as often as we drink, we will show the Lord's death until he comes. Lord, us, we want to make it. Coming to church and sitting on these benches won't save us. We need to get out there, men and women. They're waiting on us. So take the gospel to them. And this is a great opportunity, as I talked to Brother Ronroy this week. That man is so passionate to serve God. I pray that we'll continue to uplift him and continue to pray for him. Yes. And so, dear Lord, we pray that we'll take full control of this service today. We pray for the shut-ins. Yes. And I want to say to the shut-ins this morning, hold fast, yes, to that which is good, and let no one or anyone take away your crown. Amen. It may be long while you're single in the nursing home and at home. But as the Apostle John in heaven, when an elder said to John, "Who are these people standing before the throne?" John said, "These are they that have came out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." Brethren, if we are to be saved, we have to be steadfast in whatever we are doing. We got to get on the march. And so, dear Lord, we pray that you will take full control of this service today. I pray that you will come alive, and when this day shall have come to its close, we will look back and give you all the praise and all the glory that is due to your matchless name, for Christ's sake. Amen.
Good morning, church. I should say good morning, saints. Good morning, saints. You know, the day today is a special day where we get to reflect what God Almighty has done for us today. He left the splendor of glory, come into the flesh, just to redeem me and you. How powerful and how marvelous it is.
Their heads were low, their steps were slow, as they walked along the long Emmaus road. Then a man appeared, and as he drew near, he said, "Why are you so sad? Are things really that bad?" They said, "Sir, have you not heard? You must be a stranger in this town, for the one who came in the Father's name, he had been cut down. They laid his body in the ground." As they walk and talk, he began to explain about this Jesus and why he came. He opened up the scriptures and began to teach. The preachers of preachers, he began to preach. In the wilderness, the children had nothing there to eat. Manna from heaven fell down at their feet when they were dry and thirsty in a barren land. Living water came forth out of the rock in the sand. When the three Hebrew children were thrown in the flame, a fourth man appeared, they even called him by name. The manna, the water, the man, they're all the same. If you're still confused, well, let me say this real plain. It was me.
It was me.
It was me.
It was me.
I'm the one you left back there at Calvary. It was me. Who do you think hung the stars in the sky? Who do you think made the day and the night? Who made the flowers and who made the trees? And who made the sun and the moon that you see? Who gives life to all who believe? Who do you think made the blind to see? Who made the very air that you breathe? And who has conquered death and win the victory? It was me.
It was me.
It was me.
It was me.
I'm the one who died for you at Calvary. It was me. Who give you love when no one else would? Who give you life when no one else could? It was me.
How many of us can remember when God did something wonderful in our life and we didn't expect it? Say an amen to God.
Amen.
Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Isn't God good, church? You know what? God always comes through for us when we least expect it. You know, one of my favorite texts in the Bible is when God told Moses to tell the people of Israel when they were in the wilderness to bring forth offerings so they could build a sanctuary. And you know what excites me about that text? Moses had to tell the people, they brought so much that Moses had to tell the people to. You know what? We've been talking about this possibility. You know, some of us, I know, it's getting a little sometimes. Are we there yet? But you know what? I've always said, spot for a reason. You saw what happened a few weeks ago with the fire. Because the devil is not happy. So God wants his on keeping on. We have this possibility project. And we need your help. Not we need your help. God needs your help. We want you to go out and tell individuals about this project. Because this community service building is not for us. It's for our community around us. I want you to just put, if you could put up the tithe envelope in there. I could think of so many times in my life God has come through when I least expected. And as I said, I know most of you know that. So today we're going to return a faithful tithe. Tithe is how much? Of how much you earn? 10%. Do not, and I will say it over and over, do not mess with your tithe. It is sacred. Give it back to the Lord. And when you do, you will see such a blessing. So 10% goes back to the Lord. The rest you give an offering. Now, in our offering plates, if you give a loose offering is if you just drop the money in there, you do not have control of where it goes. So we have tithe envelopes. You see the QR code for those who are online. You pay, you return your tithe, and then you write down specifically what you want your offering to go towards. Because when you put it, there is no control. We have the budget. The budget is for taking care of all the expenses, the gas, the hydro in there. We need your help with that. We have the possibility project. If you could put money, you could put your offering towards that. Now, there's different ways you can give back your tithe and return your offering, and you see on the screen. For those who can't come out, like our shut-ins, just call us, and one of us will pick it up. Or you could even mail it in at 156 Bentworth Avenue, or you can just go online. Click the QR code or go to torontocentralsda.com, click on offering, and you see the selection there of what you can give return back to the Lord. Oh, and we have our debit machine. Because you know a lot of us don't carry cash anymore. We have our plastic card. If you want to use our debit machine, our treasurer, Sister Paulette, is in there, the vestry right now. And she will be there, and you can return your tithe and give a free will offering. Keep trusting in the Lord, brothers and sisters. Do not give up any hope. Return your tithe, give a faithful offering, and you see how God will bless you. And you know, God doesn't only bless you in monetary things. He blesses you with your family. He blesses you with your job. He blesses you with health as well. So I'm going to ask everyone to stand as we're going to say a word of prayer. And after the word of prayer, our deacons and deaconesses will go forward to collect today's tithe and your faithful offering. Father God, you are such a wonderful God. Lord, I cannot stop praising you because I know what you've done in my life and I see what you're doing in others' lives, oh Father. Father, sometimes it's a struggle for us, oh Lord. We see in today's economy with inflation, with gas price, so much things are going up. And sometimes, Lord, we want to diversify and say, should I return this? Should I give this to the Lord? Because I got my bills to pay. I got food to put on my table. But Father God, help us to be faithful servants to you. To know, Lord, that if we are faithful to you, there is nothing in this world you cannot do for us because you own it all. Amen. There are individuals out there, Lord, we know who want to give back to you. But Lord, they don't have a job. God, we know you could open up a way. So for those who are out there looking for work, oh Father, I pray, oh Lord, at this time that you will open up the windows of heaven and get a job for them. Amen. Lord, continue to bless this church, Toronto Central, oh Father. I've always said you've put us, this church here for a reason, and the devil is not happy. I ask you, O Father, to bless all the individuals in here, our members, our guests, or the leaders, O Father. Help us, O God, just to hold on to you. Lord, as we go through our communion service today, we ask, O Father, that everything we do, O Father, will be done to your name, honor, and glory is our prayer in your name. Amen.
Can we all stand for our scripture reading? Which is taken from Jeremiah 18, 1 to 6. And I will read it in your hearing. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, "Arise and go to the potter's house, and there I will cast you to hear my words." Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was, making something at the wheel. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter, so he made it again into another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter? Says the Lord. Look, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel." Here ends the reading of God's holy words.
Thank you, Brother Smith, for that beautiful, timely song of meditation. Over and over, he made me and he molded me into his likeness. He fashioned the clay. And I'm happy that Jesus did not throw this lump of clay away. Happy Sabbath, church. It is good to be in the house of the Lord on his holy Sabbath day to worship him in spirit and in truth, and to enjoy Christian fellowship or communion service, as was stated earlier, should have been in the first quarter. But because of the fire, and we were out of the sanctuary for 5 weeks, we have scheduled 2 communion services for the second quarter. So we will be doing 4 communion services in the year, 1 each quarter. And so at the last Sabbath, or I'm not sure, is it the last Sabbath, Pastor Darius? I'm not sure if it is the last Sabbath of June or the second to last Sabbath, we will be having our next communion service. Amen. Have a good week. How about you? On Thursday, Pastor Darius and I joined with some police officers of the 13th Division. We were not in prison or jail. We just joined with them along with other faith leaders. And we went on a tour through North York, walking in the rain and praying. And it was indeed a wonderful experience, as we fellowship with other faith leaders and as we talk with the police officers in our division. And of course, our division is not a bad division. Police officers, they were wonderful. And as we talk with them about crime, we have discovered that the major crime on the books there is drugs and selling, and of course using it, you know. And as if we can join hands and impact our community and transform lives, then of course the crime will go down and down until crime will disappear. Amen. But we look forward for that day when Jesus will come and there will be no more crying. Amen, Elder Alexander. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And of course, our upcoming week of revival will start on the 21st and we will end on the 27th. And it would be good if we could climax the week of prayer with a baptismal service. And so even though we want to re-energize and revive our church with reborn, rebirth, and refocus, we would want to direct lives into the pool, making a decision for Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Another burden on my heart that I must say before I go into the message is that of visiting you when you are sick. It is important that we know that you are sick. I spoke with a member this week who was sick. And as we talked, the member told me that she was sick and was not in church last Sabbath. And so I said, wow, if we knew, one of us would stop by and said, Pastor, and I would do well with a visit. In terms of the sickness, you know, but we didn't know, you know. And if I know, you will see me. Amen. And persons can testify of that.
Yes. Yes.
For all the sick persons here who have told me that you're sick, I have been there. And of course, my elders also visit, and we need to know. And Sister Williams is in the hospital, and some of the elders have gone. Pastor Dyrus has gone from the pastoral staff. And so, brethren, let us know that you're sick, so that we can visit with you. Because if I know, and you are in Bermanville, I am coming. And I've been there several times to visit with our sick members there and pray with them, because we want to be with you. As I share with my class this morning, that the church, when the church started, the New Testament church, that the church was called the church of Ephesus, and the church is a church of love, and we saw love and compassion and care. And once that happens in the church will grow, because we care for each other, and that is what we do here at Central. But at the end of the dispensation of the church in Ephesus, we realize in Revelation chapter 2 verse 4, the Bible says that Ephesus had lost its first love. That means the love in the church was dwindling. And by the time we come to the seventh church, the Laodicea church, in Revelation chapter 3, we get the church to being lukewarm or cold. Should not happen here in Central. We should turn that picture around, Elder Noel.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Not a lukewarm church, but a church on fire. We are hot. Because the Bible says if we are cold, the Lord can do something for us. And if we are hot, he will keep us hot. So let us remain hot.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Now to the word. The Lord has laid upon my heart. And I thank Brother Smith as I talk with the music coordinator, the music committee, as we prepare for the communion service. I requested two songs. And the leader, Sister Edwards, said, Pastor, we have a guest singer coming in, Elder Noel, and chances are they might not know the song that you want, but I got it. Over and over.
Yeah.
He molded the clay. Thank you, Sister Edwards, for going the extra mile for us. I direct your attention. If you walk with your Bible, and I hope you still do, or you have an electronic Bible, to the 18th division of the book of the weeping prophet Jeremiah. Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we have come to hear from you, because if we do not hear from you, what will we do? So now, Lord, speak through this lump of clay your message of hope and consolation to your people. And may this message prepare our hearts to eat at your table, to drink at your table, and to wash each other's feet in humility, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Pen of Inspiration says, the 18th division, the first verse, the word of the Lord, which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was making something at the wheel. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again into another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter, says the Lord? Look, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. Bear with me for the next few minutes as I speak on the subject, the potter's clay. The potter's clay. The prophet Jeremiah, a 7th century prophet, who prophesied with Daniel, Ezekiel, and Isaiah, was asked to go down to the potter's house to observe the potter at work. My God is an amazing God. He sent the prophet down to the potter's house. And he said to the prophet, observe the potter. God was about to teach Jeremiah lessons from the handiwork of the potter. Go down, observe the potter. Then the prophet, after going down and observing the potter, the prophet Jeremiah now gives a good illustration of the potter's skill. Sees the potter at work. The picture shows a potter at his wheel working with a lump of clay, making some form of vessel. In turning, he must have been there, I'm not sure how long, but in turning the wheel of the potter, a vessel he might have observed might be marred in the potter's hand. And he observes, he looked, and he figured more or less that the potter would discard this lump of clay that was now disfigured. But instead, he saw the potter working on that lump of clay until it makes an excellent vessel. You see, Jeremiah must have observed that a good potter would not throw and did not throw the clay away. The interpretation of Jeremiah's illustration of the potter concerned God's complete and unreserved control over the clay, over individual lives, over a nation, but especially in the 5th verse, over his people called Israel. The potter on his wheel is a good spiritual lesson, as noted by the hymn writer who penned these words about the potter's wheel. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way.
thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting yielded and still. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Search me, Lord, and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now, as in thy presence, humbly I bow. What a beautiful hymn that comes from this passage of scripture. Jeremiah chapter 18 and verse 1 through to verse 6. From these six verses, we will look at four important object lessons that will help us to understand clearly what God wants to do for you and me and for His church, Toronto Central. The first lesson from these six verses that we need to understand is that Jesus is the potter. I repeat it. Jesus is the potter. Jesus is not only the potter, but Jesus is the master potter. The high and exalted Holy One of Israel is indeed the master potter. Who then is a potter? A potter is one who makes pottery from clay. And I need you to understand that the clay by itself is useless. It is the potter who gives value to the clay. I can go out here and dig up a lump of clay, but with my expertise, I can do nothing with it. But a good potter is the one who digs up that clay and he molds that clay and he makes that clay valuable. Not the clay, but the potter. The clay is useless. It is the potter that makes it valuable, or lies is nothing. We are born, the Bible tells us, in sin, and we are shaken in iniquity. Yes, we were formed from the dust of the earth, and God breathed into our nostrils the breath of life, and we became living souls. We are nothing but lumps of clay. We're only valuable, Elder Noel, because the breath of God is in our bodies.
Amen.
Because God is in us.
Yes.
And God is working in us and through us His will.
Yes.
God is in us. We are nothing. But He plans to take this lump of clay. He plans to take our lives and transform it into vessels of honor. That is the God that we serve. He wants to make vessels that will reap a profit, that will be found useful, and that will bring honor and glory to His name. And so He molds us and fashions us after the similitude of His likeness. It is a potter who's working in your life and my life.
Yes.
He is the potter. And we are the clay. This is God's intention as well. He excel in taking old, worthless clay like you and me and transform it by His grace into vessels of honor and glory. He delights in taking usefulness, worthless things, and turn them into vessels of honor like His people Israel. That is the God that we serve. He is the potter. We are the clay. The second lesson that we need to understand from these six verses is that we are the clay. The prophet Jeremiah said, God's people the house of Israel. They were dug out of Egypt, as you continue to read the 18th chapter, by the potter's strong hand. They were led by God with a mighty hand. He was a pillar of cloud by day that would shelter them from the burning sun, and a pillar of fire by night to keep them warm from the falling temperature in the desert, and also to drive away wild beasts from the encampment. Israel, the Bible says, well, they were dug out of Egypt. The Lord fashioned them and guided them as he take them into the promised land, Canaan. Even though Israel murmured and complained, God did not leave them out in the cold. He successfully brought them into the land of promise, Canaan. Why? Because he is the potter, and his people, they were the clay, and he wanted to fashion them after the similitude of his likeness. So it is with you, me, and this church. We are in God's hands as clay, and he's still working on me, and he's still working on you, and he's still working on this church. God is still working on us. The third lesson from this ancient tale is that the wheel on which the clay is placed represent the promises, purposes, and providence of Almighty God. Meaning, the wheel represents God's will and the circumstances of our lives. We're constantly moving on the wheel. We are moving on the wheel of life. But we are moving in God's hand, and we will turn to the left or we will turn to the right, but the potter still working on the wheel, and he's working in our lives as we go through life. As we go through life, as we go through the wheel, Paul says, and we know that all things work together for good for them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. I want you to know that sometimes we will go through hardship. Sometimes we will go through difficulty. Sometimes we will go through persecution. Sometimes we will go through trials. Sometimes we will go through sickness. And sometimes we will experience death, but we are on the wheels, and God is still working in our lives. He's working on you, and he's working on me. Oh, praise the Lord, hallelujah. I'm glad that I am the clay. I am glad that he is the potter. I'm glad that I'm sitting on his wheel in this life. And the Bible tells me that once I'm in God's hand and he's turning the wheel, that this lump of clay will truly bring honor and glory to his name. Oh, he's still working. He's still working. He's still working on me. Oh, let me hasten on. The fourth lesson is the vessel. Yes, the vessel is our lives in the potter's hand. I am glad that I am in the potter's hand, and I am not in man's hand. I repeat that quickly, that I am happy, Elder Alexander, that I am in the potter's hand, and I am not in man's hand. Because had it been that I, Sister Swaby, was in man's hand, I would have been discarded a long time ago. Praise the Lord. Amen. But we serve a God who the Bible says that he's long suffering to us. Why? Not willing that any of us should perish, but that all of us should come to repentance. Oh, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The Bible records, the biblical record says that I was first a lump of clay, worthless, but Jesus came down with his hands and he shaped me and fashioned me into the similitude of his likeness. I am no longer a lump of clay. I am a vessel worth a honor. I am a vessel with glory. I'm a vessel that is no longer useless, but I'm a vessel of honor because I am God's child. I'm a child of the king. A tent or a cottage. The Bible tells us I do not care because he's building a mansion for me over there. The Bible tells me that I'm a prince of the king. I'm a son of the king. I have been adopted into the family of God. I am no longer a lump of clay. I am a vessel worthy of honor. Look at me. You see how handsome I am? Let my wife tell you, Elder Noel, because I am now a vessel.
Yes, Lord.
Not a monkey, as some people would want to say. I am a vessel. I was formed in the image and the likeness of God. I am created, shaped in God's image. I have the mind of Jesus. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I am a vessel. Worthy. Worthy of praise. As I end this message today, God told Adam and Eve that the day that they disobeyed, they would surely die. The devil said that they would not surely die. And Adam and Eve listened to the devil and sinned, entered the world. The vessel of Adam that God made was marred in the potter's hand. Oh, praise the Lord. Adam was marred in the potter's hand. The human race was marred in the potter's hand. Would God destroy Adam and Eve, that vessel that was marred in his hand? I say to you, no. God's love would not permit that. The Bible says that God made a promise that Jesus Christ would come. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Divine mercy says no. Even though the vessel was marred in his hand, he said, I will not throw that vessel away. So he made it again. The Bible says in the form of Jesus Christ, the second Adam, who came to redeem man from sin. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The Bible tells us that he lived a sinless life. Though he was tempted as we are in all points, yet he was without sin. Yes, through his crucifixion, through his burial in a borrowed tomb, through his triumphant resurrection on the third day, through his glorious return to his Father, Jesus went back to heaven. The second Adam, first Adam was marred, the vessel was marred in the potter's hand, but Jesus Christ, the second vessel, came. And he made a difference. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. He made a difference to your life and my life so that you and I can now obtain salvation through the second vessel, Jesus Christ, who came and died. And if you doubt it, ask Simon Peter, the lying apostle, about the master potter, because he died on Calvary's cross. If you doubt it, ask Mary Magdalene, who was caught in the act of adultery and deserved to be stoned to death, about the master potter who died on Calvary's cross for a sin. If you doubt me, ask Paul, the persecutor who became Paul after he was named Saul, about the master potter who died on the cross to save me. If you doubt me, I want you to take a walk down the street and look, and you see that woman of Samaria with five husbands, and the one she was living with was not her own. Ask her about the master potter who died on Calvary's cross to save her from her sins. The Bible says that she left her water pot and she went into the village and she came back bringing and singing, come see a man, the master potter who died on Calvary's cross to reshape our life so that this worthless clay that has become a vessel can have eternal life when Jesus comes. Amen. Talking about the master potter. Oh Lord, I am You are the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me master today. If you want to be molded, if you want to be reshaped, if you want to be that vessel of honor to Jesus, I invite you to stand with me for the prayer of consecration. Shall we pray? Oh, kind, loving, and compassionate Father, we praise your name and magnify your name because you are truly worthy to be praised. We thank you, Lord, today for this message of hope, a reminder that though our sins are like scarlet, they shall be whiter than snow. Lord, you can fashion us. You can reshape us into the similitude of your likeness. So today, the house of Israel here at 162 Bentworth Avenue, come surrendering our lives to you and rededicating our lives to you. Use us, Heavenly Father, as instruments of your peace. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that when we would have preached to others, we ourselves will not be cast away. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to eat at your table, to drink at your table today, and to show our love and our appreciation to our brothers and sisters as we will be entering the foot washing service. Continue to bless this service now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Or sing our hymn to separate as we remain standing. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. That is 5, 6, 7. The men, thank you, Eleanor. Today, the men we will be washing across at the community services center, the conference community services center. And the ladies or sisters will be washing today in the fellowship hall. The deaconesses and deacons, they have already made preparation for our arrival. My wife will lead the ladies into singing and a word of exaltation. And I will lead the men into singing, washing, and a word of exaltation. Have thine own way.
I am the clay.
Mold me and make me.
Mold me and make me.
After thy will.
After thy will.
While I am waiting.
While I am waiting.
Yielded. Us to meditate on this song as we continue to sing, have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way.
Have thine own way.
Asking right now to search you and try you.
Search me and try.
Oh, Savior, today, not tomorrow. Not next, but right now, today, Lord.
Wash me just now.
Wash me, Lord.
Wash me just now.
As in thy presence.
As in thy presence.
O Lord, humbly I bow.
Humbly I bow.
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Dying. Touch me and heal me.
Touch me and heal me.
Oh, Savior divine.
Savior divine.
We will not prayerfully move to our station, and prayerfully as we meditate on the transforming power of Christ and what he has done for us on Calvary's cross, let us claim the victory today as we participate in this service.
Feet, but the priest thing always stay here. And thing because there's people who don't go around.
So there are people who don't go around.
Yeah. So we always stay here. They sit here. There are people who don't wash their feet, so they always stay here. So the priest team stay here and sing.
Maybe if it's a new thing that we want to introduce, we'll have to do it. Thank you.
Thank you. hear my song, Lord. You fill me with music. Hear my words, Lord. You fill me with praise. Take this moment. I just can't This one is yours, Lord. I give you this day. When I am hungry, you feed me living bread. When I am thirsty,
delivered me from every fear. be ashamed. Don't never be ashamed. This torment cried, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemies. The Son of God surrounds his saints. He will deliver them. He will deliver them.
Right. Soul's in your hands. way I could ever repay all I've taken from you. Maybe, Lord, I could show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to
to bang this album part of the family because first of all we are a family, mom, a dad and four kids, and for the past year we've had several changes in our family. We've added two new son-in-laws, and everything we do is centered around the family, and we said, why don't we just do an album that
took me in.
Have a little talk with welcome you to the Lord's table. And so to continue our communion service, I invite you to stand with me and at the appropriate time, we will be singing hymn 159 to continue our service.
For a world.
and upon inspiration, he penned these words recorded in the 11th division of his first letter to the church in Corinth. Reading verse 23 onward to verse 26, he says, I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, broke it, gave it to the disciples, he said, take, eat, this is my body that is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after the same manner also he took the cup. When he had supped, saying, this is the New Testament in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death. The servant of the Lord, expanding upon the ministry of Christ, said the disciples hastily chose a replacement for the fallen Judas in Matthias. Nothing more is said of Matthias. But she said, had they waited, Paul would have been the replacement for the fallen Judas. And so as we eat and drink today, let us confess our sins and prepare to eat and drink worthily. At this time, the bread and the wine will be prayed for by Pastor Niles and Elder Niles.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us, allowing your children to be gathered here at the communion table. We thank you for this opportunity, Lord, to eat with you. And as we're about to partake, Lord, of the bread and eat the bread, I pray, Lord, that you bless it. And you bless each and every person that's going to eat it. The bread, Lord, represents you. You are the bread of life. You are the sustainer of our lives. Yes. The reason why we are alive, Lord, is because of you, because of your grace, because of your love, because of your mercy. And so, Father, we thank you. We praise your holy name. And right now I pray that you bless the bread. And as we eat of it, Lord, that we feel spiritually refreshed. I pray, Lord, that this bread nourish our bodies. And I pray, Father, that you continue to cover us in your grace, in your arms, in your love. Yes. We thank you for all you've been doing for us, all you're currently doing for us, and all you have in store for your children. As we're at the communion table, Lord, we are grateful. Yes. We are so happy for the fact that we have a Father, a loving Father, who watches over his children. Yes. We have a loving God who never fails, who is faithful, and who is good. This morning, Lord, we praise your holy name. And as we eat of the bread, Lord, I pray for a special blessing to be upon it as your children eat of it. It's in your holy name that I pray. Amen. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, we want to stop by here today, O Lord, and just thank you, O Father, for all the wonderful things that you have done for us.
Yes.
You have woken us up this morning, O Father, and for this we want to thank you.
Yes.
We want to thank you, O Lord, for this communion service, O Father, that we as brothers and sisters could come here, O Father, and fellowship and remember the sacrifice that you have made for us.
Yes.
Oh, that blood that washes us whiter than
snow.
Oh Lord, we know without the shedding of the blood that salvation will be nothing.
Yes.
So we want to thank you, God, for that sacrifice you made, O Father. That God, we would have that opportunity to one day to sup with you.
Yes.
And to fellowship with you. God, we want to thank you for all the wonderful things that you have done for us.
Yes.
It is only through you, O Father, through your blood. No one else could have made that sacrifice but you.
Yes.
Because you lived that perfect life.
Yes.
And through you, O Father, we can live that perfect life. simple, that one of these days, oh Father, we will sup with you forever, 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 and forever. So until then, oh God, even though we get discouraged, help us to hold on to you. It's our prayer in your name.
Amen.
Please be seated in 271. Break out the bread of life. Dear Lord, as God is risen there.
Great.
presence daily live. The flowing wounds, sir.
a part of the body of Christ. The songwriter says, what can wash away my sins?
Nothing but the blood
of the Lord Jesus. We give thanks for the blood that was shed on Calvary's cross for the remission of our sins. Let us confess and let us prayerfully eat the emblem of Christ's broken body. In meditation, let us drink the emblem of his people. Invite the deacons to be seated and the elders and pastors as we now partake of the rest.
Happened, and I know he
at this time, we'll have the deacon or the deaconess collect the glasses. And if you're from another denomination or custom in the Adventist Church, after a communion service, we collect a special offering, and that offering will go to our needy of our church. Amen. Okay, let us pray for the offering. Father in heaven, we thank you again for being so good to us. We thank you for health. We thank you for strength. And Father, as we're about to collect that special offering, that we go to the needy of our church, I ask that you bless it. You'll work upon the heart on each and every one of us, that as we give, let us give with a willing heart. Bless it again, I pray, in Jesus' name.
As we retrieve the glass and the offering is collected, we will forego 355 as Brother Junior Smith is prepared to bless our hearts with a special music. So as we retrieve the glasses and the offering is collected, come help us. How many are we saying? We can just send.
Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I never know just how he came to love me so. He looks beyond my faults and saw my need. I shall soul would be a drifting ship without a harbor from the angry waves. Calvary's cross
shines brighter in that anxious night. And just in time His mercy rescues me. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary. Just wave your hands, man. To view the cross where Jesus died for me.
Praise the Lord. He looks beyond my fault and your fault. And He saw our need. And we're happy that we serve a God who has promised never to leave us, never to forsake us, but that He will always be with us, even to the end of our journey here on earth, until we meet in the kingdom of God. The Bible declares that the first communion service of our Lord did not end with prayer. Because after the Lord met with the disciples in that upper room, wash the disciples' feet, including Peter, who did not want to be washed by the Savior. But with his limited understanding of what the Lord was doing, Peter declared, "Not only my feet, but wash me all over." And the scriptures declare that after they had washed feet and after they had supped, that the Lord said to his disciples, "I will not drink of the fruit of the vine again until that day." It was a promise. "When I will drink it new in my Father's kingdom." He is waiting for you and for me to have that supper and to drink from the fruit of the vine again in his Father's kingdom. It is also a blessed assurance that Jesus will return. Because he said, I will not do it again until that day. It is a promise that will be fulfilled. If you believe it, it will be fulfilled. If you do not believe it, it still will be fulfilled. And the Bible declares that after that, they went out into the Mount of Olives singing a hymn. It was one of the psalms that they sang, but it was a psalm of hope and encouragement, a psalm to remind them that for them to be privileged to drink with him, they had to remain faithful until he returned. And so our hymn as we depart that I want you to always remember is hymn 600. Sweet promise is given to all who believe. Behold, I come quickly, my own to receive. Hold fast till I come. That was exactly what Jesus told his disciples. Hold fast. Because if you hold fast, you will be privileged to drink with me. God bless you. As I say, thanks to the elders, deacons and deaconesses who prepared for this service, and for you who turn out to participate in the service. And happy birthday to Elder James, who is celebrating his birthday on the Lord's Day. God bless you.
Oh! seated as you are.